for me. Let me see if I can, there we go. The challenge in this work is matching the evaluation process and design to the nature of the situation. And so we're going to distinguish different kinds of situations in order to think about what kind of evaluation is appropriate. There are now a great panorama of different evaluation models, approaches, theories, and methods, and that makes the challenge of matching a premier challenge of our professional work. One way to do that is to understand the special challenges of seeing things through a complexity lens. And that means looking at some of the implications of complexity concepts for evaluation. Here are four complexity concepts that I think give us insights into some of the challenges of doing evaluation in complex situations. For example, nonlinearity is the notion that very small actions can have large reactions or large implications. Our traditional logic models are based upon the idea that there's a fairly constant relationship between inputs, activities, outputs, and outcomes, and that a certain amount of input will yield a certain level of output and a certain level of outcome. Nonlinearity means that very small things can have large reactions and large implications. So for example, when the H1N1 virus, which was called swine flu, hit a year ago, it had different effects in different places. One of the places where it had a huge impact was a few people got quite sick in Mexico City, and it led to virtually shutting down the nightlife of Mexico City for several weeks. The economy took a huge hit out of all proportion to the number of people who were actually sick. In programs, there can be a conflict that suddenly emerges between two participants, or between a staff person and a participant, that has ripple effects and affects the entire implementation of the program. It's not part of the expectations of the program. It's not part of what was in the design of the program. But especially with equity-focused evaluations, which is the focus here, where there may well be power dynamics at play, where people from different positions in life, different ethnic groups, different geographic areas that may have historical conflicts. At any moment, these conflicts can flame up and take over a program. And so the evaluation implication is that we have to have ways of paying attention to things that emerge that aren't expected, that aren't part of the anticipated implementation of the program, and get feedback about what is happening sooner rather than later so that the program can adjust as these issues emerge. The second idea is the idea of emergence itself. That one example of this is that our data in evaluation tends to be largely at the individual level. For example, if we do pretests and post-tests, or do random assignment to a program, people get randomly assigned to treatment and control groups as individuals. But in fact, when people go through programs as social beings, we tend to find each other. You know, people connect. They do what is called in complexity theory self-organize. And so, in fact, people don't just go through programs as individuals. They go through programs in social groups, and those different groups will have different experiences than people that are in another group. People who share some background or who happen to have some shared interests or some shared characteristics will find each other and will begin to experience the program in particular ways that other participants are not. So one evaluation implication of self-organizing is that we move beyond just treating individuals as a unit of analysis and have ways of watching for groups of people who emerge and have experiences together. Think about your own educational experiences, those of you on this webinar. You probably made some friends in education programs, and those friendships affected what you got out of the program. I've done hundreds of evaluations over 40 years, and one of the common questions that we ask people is, what were the most important factors in the things that you got out of this program? And the most common answer I hear is the friendships I formed with other participants, the people I got to know, the relationships I formed with staff. Those are emergent phenomena, dynamic phenomena, the changes that are going on around us. When you may be doing a program in the health sector and things happen in the political sector, the economic sector, the finance sector, the agricultural sector, that affect what's going on in the health sector. So from a systems point of view, even though we may be intervening in one particular program area, the things going on around us, things like AIDS, things like food insecurity, things like political conflicts can have dramatic impacts on a program, and we have to be able to capture those dynamic interactions to do justice to explaining what occurred in the program. And then dealing with uncertainty itself, what is called the getting to maybe phenomenon, that in complex environments, because there are a number of dynamic and emergent and nonlinear phenomena going on, we have to watch for the unpredictable and the uncertain. And this becomes especially important in paying attention to unanticipated consequences. My view is that we give a lot of lip service in evaluation to unanticipated consequences. But in fact, the evidence is that most evaluation designs actually don't have a method for turning up unanticipated consequences. Most evaluation designs are focusing upon predetermined goals, upon performance measures, upon an M&E system where all the resources are going towards predetermined evaluation questions. And the only way to really go out and find out what kind of phenomena are emerging, what are the unanticipated consequences, what are the unpredictable and uncontrollable things that are happening in a program, is to do open-ended field work where you go out into the field and see what actually has occurred. Interview people, observe the program in the field, and despite some token attention to unanticipated consequences, my view is that most evaluation designs don't do a very good or serious job of that. So let's turn to defining complexity. And the work that I'm going to share with you comes originally from a book that I did with two Canadian authors, a book called Getting to Maybe, How the World Has Changed, that was based on case studies of major change efforts, like the microfinance work of Mohamed Yunus and other major social movements that have had a big impact on the world in complex dynamic environments. This is also based upon the fourth chapter of the developmental evaluation book that I've done. And what it involves is distinguishing between simple, complicated, and complex situations. Now, there are lots of ways of doing this, but I'm going to share one particular framework that I find reasonably understandable and helpful in distinguishing interventions and environments that are simple from those that are complicated and complex. This framework is also used by Patricia Rogers in her new book on purposeful program theory. So we're going to look at making these distinctions by using a two-dimensional matrix. Along the bottom of this matrix is the degree to which we have research knowledge about how to produce a certain desired outcome, the degree of certainty dimension along the bottom. And along the side is a horizontal dimension about the degree to which key stakeholders agree about what ought to be done. So that when we are in simple space, there's a high degree of certainty about how to produce a desired outcome and a high degree of agreement about that desired outcome. An example would be the worldwide commitment to eradicate polio. We know how to eradicate polio. We have a vaccine. The World Health Organization has developed campaign techniques for inoculating populations against polio, and the world has made a commitment through its United Nations, through UNICEF, through governments, through the World Health Organization to make eradicating polio a worldwide priority. In this simple space, it is possible to plan and control, to do logic models, to implement those logic models, because we have a high degree of knowledge about what to do from research. The research developed the polio vaccine, and there's a high degree of agreement that this is a good thing to do. That is a space where a plan and control way of operating works particularly well. The metaphor that we use here is following a recipe. The recipe is essential. Recipes are tested to assure replicability. If you've got a recipe, you don't need a lot of other expertise. You just need to know how to follow the recipe. And recipes are aimed at producing the same results every time. This is what we've come to call best practices in the field of evaluation. But best practices only work in situations where there's a high degree of certainty and a high degree of agreement. When we move further out on the uncertainty dimension, where things become technically complicated, they become technically complicated because there are lots of different parts that have to be coordinated in order to get the desired outcome. And the metaphor here is sending a rocket to the moon. Yes, there are formula. Yes, sending one rocket increases the likelihood of another one working out. It requires a high degree of specialization and expertise in many fields. Rockets have similarities, and there's a fairly high degree of certainty, but still there are so many parts, so many different things that have to be coordinated that it's far from sure. And so both of the shuttle disasters in which shuttles blew up were examples of a complicated situation where one small part, the O-ring in the first shuttle, the piece of foam in the second space shuttle, when those small parts malfunctioned, the entire shuttle blew up, a nonlinear effect. One small failure led to the failure of the entire mission. Things become socially complicated where there are lots of different stakeholders and there are conflicts. This is, again, especially important in equity-focused evaluations where people with different degrees of power may disagree about what's desirable to do. And in fact, in the investigations of the two shuttle disasters, while there were technical reasons for the failure, the O-ring and the foam, the full investigation showed that the shuttle disasters were also traced to conflict within the National Space and Aeronautics Administration between the engineers and the political administrators about how much risk to take. The socially complicated interactions around the power dynamics of who would determine whether to take the risk of sending a shuttle into space was the ultimate cause of the shuttle disaster. When there's a high degree of technical complication, a high degree of socially complicated in areas like implementing human rights agreements, gender equity agreements, environmental initiatives, situations that pose the challenge of both coordinating and integrating many different players, but also getting agreement upon outcomes. And in areas where we don't really know how to produce the desired results, then we are in the zone of complexity, where there's a high degree of uncertainty about what to do. We don't know, we don't have any recipes for how to reduce community violence. We don't have any recipes for how to overcome conflicts in zones of high degree of conflict. And so these situations that are highly uncertain, low degrees of agreement, give us the need to evaluate in highly emergent, innovative situations that aren't going to simply follow the recipe of best practices. The metaphor we hear use here is raising the child. Formula have only limited application. Raising one child gives no assurance of success with the next. Expertise can help, but is not sufficient. Relationships are key. Every child is ultimately unique. And even if you do the best you can with parenting. You can't be sure whether you get the desired outcomes for your child because of all the other things that can impede and impinge on those desired outcomes. There's not complete control. The implications of this for evaluation is that we have to be able to be highly responsive, be agile, get new data as situations unfold. And this is true both on the management side and on the evaluation side. So people who are making these distinctions between simple, complicated, and complex situations in the management world, like David Snowden, who's the former director of knowledge management at International Business Machines, IBM, and is now a very widely sought after business and international development consultant, wrote an important article in the Harvard Business Review based upon these distinctions between simple, complicated, and complex. The article was called A Leader's Framework for Decision Making. And the conclusion of that article was that wise executives tailor their approach to fit the complexity of the circumstances they face. The implication for evaluators is that wise evaluators tailor their approach to fit the complexity of the situations they face, of the circumstances they face. And what this means for evaluation is that we need to be able to not simply do midterm reports and end of project reports, but where the environment is changing rapidly, we need to be able to adopt and adapt our samples to getting new data more quickly as the conditions and programs change, as the circumstances and programs change. This is important in circumstances where there is humanitarian aid being delivered in because of natural disasters or because of political disasters, where the circumstances are changing rapidly. And the data have to be regularly updated to be made relevant, to figure out what do we need to know now in order to help the program adapt to changing circumstances. What unanticipated consequences are emerging that we need to be able to do something about? How do we help people adapt to these new kinds of conditions? And so the kind of conditions that have typically challenged traditional evaluation approaches are the conditions of high degree of innovation, ongoing development, high degree of uncertainty, dynamic situations, emergent situations, and finally, the increasing attention to overall systems change, trying to bring about changes not just at the project or the program level, but in complex dynamic systems themselves. And to evaluate in these situations, we need to be able to gather data quickly, turn it around quickly, change our instruments, change our samples, watch for emergent populations. One of the equity-focused areas where this is particularly relevant, and I'm finding the work being taken up in the international arena, are in situations of conflict management and negotiation. It's very difficult in those kinds of situations where agreements are being negotiated to predetermine what the outcomes of conflict negotiations are going to be, because the situation is dynamic, it's unfolding. It depends on who's coming to the table, what they're willing to consider, what the short-term objectives are that emerge, how the implementation unfolds. And so the targets are changing. The issues are changing. And we need dynamic evaluation approaches that allow us to track those highly innovative, adaptive kinds of interventions in complex dynamic systems. Let me stop with that very rapid overview of complexity and invite your questions and see if I can respond. Over to you, Stuart.